So I got a lot of feedback on GPT-3, a lot of people excited about GPT-3 and the technology, and a lot of people on the waiting list. I'm on the waiting list too. I signed up early and have been on the waiting list for almost 2 months, and I've been waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting. So I got sick and tired of waiting and decided to sign up and download GPT-2, install it on my computer. So I'm gonna walk through how to get GPT-2 set up, some of the pitfalls, some of the things I learned in training a number of different models on GPT-2, and some of the things to be careful of if you're starting a company using artificial intelligence technology, specifically GPT-3, and how to be careful to make sure that your company is set up for the long term. All right, let's get into it. So in my previous videos, I showed a number of different examples of GPT-3, and I've gotten a lot of comments of people wanting to try out those samples. Well, a lot of those samples aren't yet publicly available because GPT-3 itself isn't publicly available. So you can get on the waiting list, and I've been on the waiting list for months and months, and really, from what I've seen, the waiting list has not made a ton of progress. So GPT-2 was released a while ago. It's available on GitHub, so no problem. Download a virtual environment, Anaconda, get that set up on your computer, create a GPT-2 environment, install the right version of Python, TensorFlow, and GPT-2-Simple. Check out the code from GitHub. Download the 774 million parameter model. It's just a couple gigs. Swear at your computer for a couple of hours. Boom, you have the Shakespeare sample working. So now I can give my computer a prompt and it'll continue to speak in Shakespeare with the thought that I started. So as am I, a smoke rises out of fire. So smoke rises out of sweet smoke. So sweet it is. So sweet it is for me to win the love of the sun, to tear the dregs of the cheeks of old men. I didn't say it was good. It just sounds like Shakespeare. Now, it's not particularly great. I don't happen to speak or have the need to speak Shakespeare on a daily basis, but it just shows the power of the technology and what's possible even on your own machine. Now, I'm on a MacBook and this was taking hours and hours and hours. In fact, it was taking so long that it really was starting to frustrate me, and I spent an entire day trying to figure out how to get virtual Windows running under boot camp on my Mac. Now, this is because MacBooks aren't set up with the right graphics accelerator. Most artificial intelligence is trained on a GPU, and the Mac just has a different GPU that's not really trained for TensorFlow and the technology I was using. I did find a better way to do this, and that's using Google Colab. So Google Colab is a fantastic technology. It allows you to run a GPU in the cloud using Google servers. And so all those same samples that I was experimenting with on my local computer for a library called GPT-2-Simple, you're able to run in Google Colab in the cloud. Google Colab is a collaborative platform for running notebooks. These are based on a technology called Jupyter. It's a combination of code and notes. And you can simply go through the notebook, either modifying the code or running it step by step. It's a really interactive and easy way to learn artificial intelligence, learn how this technology works, and run models right in the cloud without having to update your computer or add a graphics card. So I'm using a notebook from Max Woolf, who wrote the library GPT-2-Simple. And it's a fantastic collab notebook that really walks you through the steps of setting up and training an artificial intelligence using GPT-2. I won't bore you with the code and the specifics, but I've linked the notebook in the description below so you can take a look at that and follow along step by step. You choose how big of a model you want to train, and there's a couple options for the size of the model that you want to train. You download the open source model and then you fine tune that model. So you can fine tune it by telling it what you want examples are. In my own experiments, I trained three models to get a sense of how it works. The first model was trained on Shakespeare, which I showed you before. The second model I trained on my Twitter history, and Twitter makes it easy for you to download your entire Twitter history. And by tuning GPT-2-Simple, I was able to train it to tweet as if it was me. Here's some of the best tweets that GPT-2-Simple was able to create. The internet is like a series of tubes with a pipe that leads to nowhere. There is no escape. Killed another software project that was on life support. Sad? Nope. I love creating focus for the bigger things we have going on. Some of the tweets worked, some were confusing. Of course, that's true of normal Twitter too. The third example, I tried to train GPT-2 on a series of jokes. I was trying to get it to be funny. So I downloaded an entire library of jokes and tried to fine-tune GPT-2 to tell jokes. Now, I was able to get GPT-2 to have a really good structure of jokes, and so the format of what it was producing was structured to be like a joke, but many of the jokes that it produced weren't actually that funny. So hopefully this gives you some of the bare bones steps you need to get started with GPT-2. Now, if you're thinking about using artificial intelligence for your startup, there's some caveats, some things to be aware of. The first is AI is often about the data. And in my own experimentation, whether it was the Twitter history or the Shakespeare archive or the joke database, the database of the data that you're feeding and training your AI model is really important, really critical to getting good results. And fine-tuning that data, fine-tuning how you're training that artificial intelligence is really what separates a great artificial intelligence model and one that's really okay. So really plan on spending a lot of time curating your examples, curating your samples to get better results with your artificial intelligence model. The second thing to think about when starting a business using artificial intelligence is your dependencies. Are you dependent on OpenAI and an API that they're providing? And what happens if that API stops functioning or functions differently? I happen to think that using artificial intelligence can be a great differentiator for a startup, but if you're using the same API that every single other developer is using for their model, you're not really creating an opportunity for clear differentiation. So think about how you will differentiate your startup using an open API versus something that's proprietary and special to your startup. You don't want to have a dependency on a third party that prevents you from really being competitive and differentiating yourself. I've seen a lot of pitches from startups that use artificial intelligence, and it's important to remember that the business side of an artificial intelligence company is as important, if not more important, than the artificial intelligence itself. Think about the business that you're trying to establish and how that business channel will really function. Where you're gonna get your customers, how you're gonna differentiate yourself. And long term, as more companies incorporate artificial intelligence, what's gonna set you apart in terms of what you're doing from a business perspective from your competition? And lastly, GPT-2 and GPT-3 are hot technologies today. Lots of people are talking about them, but you can be sure that Google and Amazon and Apple and Facebook and many other companies will create technologies in the future to compete with GPT-2 and 3 and provide technologies for application developers. So think about long-term how you plan to pivot and incorporate or use new technologies. By creating strong dependencies with one provider, you could actually limit your long-term potential for your startup or business. So if you're a startup using artificial intelligence technology or GPT-2 or GPT-3, I'd love to hear from you. Leave a comment down below telling me how you're using the technology and how you think you'll differentiate. And if you're new to the channel, I talk about entrepreneurship, technology, and design, and I hope I'll see you on the next one.